Let's next slide, please. So the first, what I wanted to show is, and we do this in the report with the SIP, but here I just jump from the Survey of Consumer Finances, and you'll see in a minute that they largely give you relatively similar results. These results, the distribution between by race and ethnicity, in the Survey of Consumer Finances is household data. There is sort of a weird way of allocating it to individuals, but you miss a lot of people. So we switched over to the Survey of Income and Program Participation to show that the racial differences you see by household, where the household is identified as Black or white, dependent on the race, racial identification of the householder, is not a reflection of some weird household composition. That by and large, I think we mentioned this in the report, by and large, because we have the data of the racial and ethnic self-identification of the spouse, 80 to 90% of people are married of somebody of the same race or ethnicity. But the individual retirement wealth data in the Survey of Income and Program Participation shows very similar racial and ethnic gaps. Again, you see in this case, white household, white individuals have slightly more retirement wealth, and this is just account balances, than Asian Americans. Again, multiple times more than Black or Latino households. But the one group that always jumps out in multiple of our analyses is that Latinos, Hispanics, and those of Spanish origin tend to have the lowest wealth. And in that group, Salvadorans tend to be the lowest wealth group. Again, this is sort of why we use the SIP, because it does give us extra details on these subpopulations. The SIP actually has multiple more groups, larger number of groups than we list here, but we combined a number of groups in order to make sure that the sample sizes are large enough. I can assure you they are large enough for Salvadorans, and those numbers are always stunningly low. Next, please. And this wasn't sort of like, if some people would think these are data from 2022 and 2021, that this wasn't an artifact. This inequality wasn't an artifact of the pandemic. This has been persistent for years. Ignore this weird blip for others in the beginning in the 1990s. It has to do with some demographic changes. By and large, the gaps persist through over decades. This is like three decades of data. This is from the survey, the distributional financial accounts of the Federal Reserve. As I said, like we used multiple data sources. This is one that has sort of the longest time series. It is quarterly data. And as you can see, there isn't sort of a shrinking of the gap. Let's say the light blue line and the orange line here. There's sort of weird things happening, especially Latinos lose a lot of money during the financial crisis in 2008 and its aftermath. But the gaps overall, and we notice from wealth overall, not just retirement wealth, that the gap has stayed high. There is no clear trend towards shrinking it. And even as our demographics are changing dramatically in this country, these gaps have persisted. And even as we are aging in all populations, these gaps have persisted. Okay, next slide. Okay. How do we explain this? What are sort of the factors that correlate with this? And we do a Oaxaca blinder decomposition analysis in the report that gives us sort of an order of magnitude which factors matter. I didn't show that here. Like, you have to trust, if you're not, you don't know what a decomposition is, in this case, you have to trust me that we know what we did. And those of you who know what these decompositions are, you can look at the exact data in the report. The primary vehicle for saving for retirement in the United States is through employer-sponsored retirement benefits, that is defined benefit pensions and defined contribution accounts such as 401ks or 403bs. The unequal access to retirement benefits explains 42%. And in this case, unequal access means unequal participation rates. Explain 42% of the Black-white retirement wealth and 51% of the Latino-white retirement wealth gap. So this is the single largest factor that explains in this decomposition. We can attribute almost half of the gap to unequal participation rates between these groups. But this unequal access, the unequal participation in retirement plans follows from unequal access, unequal availability of a retirement plan at work. This comes from differences in industry and occupational segregation. For instance, in the public sector, the sponsorship rate is much higher of retirement benefits than it is in the private sector. For public sector workers, 69% of Black public sector workers participate in a retirement plan compared to 48% of private sector workers, Black private sector workers. And for Latinos, the difference is 62% compared to 37%. Again, massive gaps. The gaps aren't that large by race and ethnicity in the public sector. The reason why I'm pointing that out is I've made this point in a number of publications together with some colleagues at the Center for American Progress, with whom I'm also affiliated. Part of that is it's the public sector often instead or in addition to Social Security, but also because unions are more common within the public sector. David Madland at the Center for American Progress and I have written about that. That is sort of reflected, especially in a more equal distribution of retirement benefits by race and ethnicity, by union membership, but also in the public sector. The point I want to make, and I'll show you some data, is that the participation in the unequal participation in retirement plans at work reflects to a very small degree unequal eligibility. That, and I'll come back to that when we talk about risks. But Black and Latino workers are slightly less likely to be eligible for an employer plan when one exists than is the case for white or Asian workers. But once they're eligible, all groups, all racialized groups, participate at a rate of 90 to 95%. So this isn't, again, so this is the first piece of the puzzle to the story, that this is not a story of individual failings. Once people are eligible, they have enough hours, they've been long enough, they vested, 90 to 95% of people, regardless of how they're racialized, will participate in this. It is the first two steps. That's where the inequality comes in. The employer, some employers offering it, some employers not offering it. And then to a lesser degree, people are eligible or they're not eligible, making sort of the unequal distribution worse. And then finally, when it comes to the individuals deciding to participate or not, most people will participate regardless of race or ethnicity. Next slide, please. Okay. The blue ones are employer offers a plan, and then the participation is people participate. We're leaving out the people are working for their the eligibility rate, which is right between the two and follows the pattern of the orange line a little more closely than the blue line does. But what I wanted to show here is really depends on whether your employer offers a plan to begin with. For Asian Americans in general, the rate is higher. Puerto Ricans is also very high. We don't know exactly why that is the case. But as you can see, again, for Salvadorans, it's the lowest rate. Again, your participation rate, whether you participate in a retirement benefit, DB or DC, follows very closely to whether your employer offers a plan in the first place. So the biggest obstacle for people to actually save in retirement outside of Social Security in the United States is whether your employer offers a plan. Because we have a racially segmented labor market with heavy concentration, for instance, of many Latinos in the construction industry, also in hotels and restaurants, where especially in the residential construction sector, where retirement plans aren't as common as they are in other industries, that sort of sets the stage for that kind of inequality in retirement benefits to begin with. Next stage, next slide, please. All right. So, as I said, the biggest chunk of the difference is explained by access. The next one is contributions. What do people contribute to their retirement plans as share of their earnings? It is a statistically significant factor, differences in contributions and what people get for their contributions. Okay. It's important to remember that about the decompositions for those of you who are familiar with them, but also those of you who want to know more about it. A decomposition tells us the importance of one factor in explaining, in this case, inequality in retirement savings. But that measure, that explanatory factor, in this case, attributed to contributions to retirement plans, captures two things. First, the actual raw differences in how much people contribute as share of their earnings. And the second part is what people get for their earnings, like the rate of return that they receive for what they're getting from their earnings. And what you will see is the contribution rates between Black and white households are very small, which means what we see as the explanation in terms of, all right, contribution rates explain part of the difference, 3 to 7% of the wealth difference. That is attributable to the fact that Black and Latino households get less for their money. That has nothing to do with higher fees. That probably plays a small role, but a very small role. But it's just simply what we'll see is greater liquidity preferences, and they're just it picks up, the statistics pick up some of the liquidity preferences, which reduce automatically the rates of return that people get because they can't invest in riskier asset over longer periods of time. The median employee contributions are highest for Asian Americans than for any other groups, but beyond the other four groups, Black households, Latino households, those of other multiple races, and white households, generally, the rates are very similar. These are the median rates. But the flip side of that is again, this 3 to 7% difference. The flip side of that is that especially Black and Latino households don't get as much bang for their buck when they contribute money. And largely because they have more economic risk exposure, they have greater liquidity, they have higher, more pension loans, larger, lower equity allocations, and they have shorter financial planning horizons, and those hold even if we broke this down by age or something like that. And we'll talk about these financial risks, economic risks, especially what they are and which ones are the most important ones and stuff like that in a minute. Next slide, please. So this puts together the slide data from two data sets, the median employee contribution rates in the survey of consumer finances and the survey of income and program participation rates. I do not show the median employer contribution rate, because the median employer contribution rate is, regardless of whichever group, almost always 3%, the median. The average is a little higher, but the averages in these data sources have a number of problems that are sort of make it iffy to report them. But at the median for the typical worker, basically all groups other than Asian households contribute 5% of their earnings. The interesting thing is that for Asian Americans, both data, and the interesting for all of these is that both data sets pretty much give us the same numbers. There's a little bit of a difference for white households, but it's minor. Again, we also have a long page in the report where we go through other saving measures. And to summarize the literature, Black households and Latinos, those are the main ones who have been studied. So we don't know exactly about Asian Americans, but that's less relevant here, tend to save as much or more in terms of active saving contributions to their retirement accounts or to anything as white households do. So this notion that structurally or that culturally or whatever else people bring up, Black or Latino households or people are worse savers is just simply not borne out of the data. In fact, when you look at the Survey of Consumer Finances, which has a measure of asking people, do you regularly or save regular or irregular amounts? Typically, Black and Latino households tend to be as likely or more likely than white households to say they're saving. And there's a number of other studies, and including some stuff that Dania and I have done around retirement savings that show that generally people, in our conclusion, actually Black households save more than white households under similar circumstances. And we'll talk about that a little bit when I talk about economic risk. So this notion that there is some sort of like something wrong with Black or Latino people, that they simply can't, like, that I don't know what the cultural story is, but it comes up all the time. And I'm going to be blunt, it's offensive, but it does happen. And I just want to say, like, Dania and I laugh about this. It is sort of a struggle to convince people that data simply does not show this, and people need to get off it and look at other cases. And the other reasons why we see these massive inequalities in wealth, in particular retirement wealth in this case, are structural. All right, next slide, please. These are the greater liquidity needs. I know Jack Vanderhey has written about this. I know Taha at MIT has written about this, that we see, like, it doesn't matter. Like, we use 401k loans. I think Jack and Taha looked at in their various papers on also at withdrawals. We didn't look at withdrawals because they tend to be very, very small number of people who actually say they have withdrawn money pre-retirement. But what you'll see is here, especially African Americans are much more likely to have a 401k loan outstanding. So is Latinos and those of other multiple races than is the case for either white households or for white house or Asian households. The other flip side of that is especially Asian Americans and white households tend to have much larger shares of their retirement savings, in this case, the retirement accounts, invested in equities and stock markets, and meaning that they take greater risks in their retirement savings. And our story is, and the data shows this, they can take more risks than other groups because they have fewer other risks. And that generates higher rates of return. Again, this is borne out by the data, by the most recent studies. I'm not sure Jack did that in his research, but I know Taha did in his, that this sort of like this liquidity need is a major factor in contributing to the retirement income wealth inequality. And you see sort of the 10-year plus planning horizon by the groups. Again, for Asian Americans and whites, it's almost 1 in 5. And for all other groups, it's much smaller. It's less than 1 in 10 for Black and Latino households. Again, what that means is greater economic risks force people to focus more on the short term, and thereby be safer. It doesn't prevent them from saving, but it forces them to be more cautious in their retirement savings. So let's go to the next slide. And yeah, greater risk exposure. All right. Most groups of color, Black and Latino households, as well as workers of other or multiple races, face greater risk exposure. This is important because often people forget this when they talk about the risk. There's two parts to this. One is they're more likely to experience those risks. The second part is when they experience those risks, they come with higher costs for Black or Latino households. Different risk exposures matter for different groups. They vary by group. But together, they explain a large share of the racial retirement savings gap. We discuss a number of specific ones. So there are the labor market related ones, such as higher unemployment rates for Black and Latino workers, longer spells of unemployment, longer periods of unemployment, less predictable schedules, all that income volatility from day to day, from month to month. requires that people sort of have to have more liquidity. And what we see is, at least in one instance, and I'll talk to that in a minute, what we see is that people prepare for that by saving more at the front end, but then also taking out more, like having more liquidity, more cash holdings, greater likelihood of withdrawals or 401k loans in larger 401k loan amounts when they face those risks. Unexpected financial demands from kinship networks. Yes, I'll have some. What that means is basically people, there is an unexpected demand. Somebody in your kin network, father, mother, brother, sister, aunt, uncle, has a financial need, loses their job, has a healthcare emergency or something like that. They then turn to a household in their kin network, often of the same race or ethnicity, and need financial support. Those, in on average, those demands are predictable, but when they exactly will come and how large they will be is often unexpected. And so what households that are saving, that have the opportunity to save for retirement, especially Black households, seem to be doing is that they contribute more to their retirement savings plan, actually do more so than white households, and then sort of wait until there's something happens and then take out a loan from their 401k to help their family members. And then there is sort of the non-labor market related risk factors, such as health risks, higher like working in industries where with greater occupational hazards, less access to healthcare providers, worse health insurance, and so on and so forth. Incarceration risk. We sort of ignore that often in much of our work. Yet a substantial share of any household has, regardless of race or ethnicity, has or had a family member in prison. That comes with enormous financial demands. That person might be out of the labor market. There's legal costs, there's bail, and so on and so forth. And once the person comes out of prison, they have a felony record that makes it harder for them to get back in the labor market. The differences are massive by race, ethnicity, but even for white households, there is a substantial share with people who have had interactions with the criminal justice system. And then the discrimination risks, that is just sort of what when we teach economics of discrimination, what we call taste-based discrimination, I just hate how you look kind of stuff. Okay. Let's go to the next slide. This is the share of people who provide financial support to somebody in the kinship network, a friend, a family member. These numbers, as you can see, are very large. Among all, how, like, and just look at the number for Black and Black households. For all wage and salary households, 20% provide informal financial support to somebody in the kinship network. For 401k holders, it's 26%. And this goes to the point, like Dania and I have written about this for the Journal of Retirement, this goes to the point that we make there, that people of color, in particular Black householders, are taking advantage of a retirement savings plan at work to prepare for the eventuality that somebody in their family network needs the money. We also make a big deal and we show data that this isn't sort of like, oh, I'm just going to give birthday money to my grandkids. This is really helping people out in an emergency or when people in the network have very little wealth. That same is true, not to the same kind of differentials, but for Latino households and for other multiple races. Again, the risk of the economic risk that's associated with having to help family members actually for most households other than Asian households doesn't drive them away from saving. It actually drives them towards saving more and preparing more for the eventuality of such an event. For this particular risk, I have lots of data, but I suspect that this is the same for pretty much all risks that we know. All right, can we go to the next slide? All right, I should say we in the, our Journal of Retirement article, Dania and I overlaid a risk of having to help family and friends in an emergency overlays also goes along not only with higher savings rate and higher participation rates, but it also goes along with much higher likelihood of 401k loans, especially for Black households, and not only more loans, but much larger loan amounts. Okay. Retirement savings are unequally distributed by race or ethnicity. The gaps have not shrunk over time. That's at least the most positive spin I can put on the data. There are some suspicions that wealth inequality has actually risen over time, probably not in the retirement space. We can talk about why not. The biggest thing is having access to a retirement plan. That means working for an employer that offers a retirement plan and being eligible for that plan. Once those two things are in place, most people will participate. A huge number, huge share, 90% plus, will participate in the retirement savings plan. Retirement contribution differences play a small role, and they're largely a difference in what people get for their contributions, which means the biggest, like the next biggest chunk in terms of explaining the retirement gap is the various risk exposure, be that incarceration risk or family risk from the family network and other forms of economic risks that prevent people from saving or building up wealth at same rates as white or Asian households do. Again, I should say, like, I haven't shown a lot of data here. We have a discussion about Asian American households specifically in the report. Where Asian Americans look quite different from white households is, especially in the SIP, is particularly on the size of family, more multi-generational household with greater responsibilities for those households, and at least in the survey of income program participation, a greater likelihood of paying financial support to somebody outside of the household. And their Asian Americans are much more likely than even Black households. So there is sort of a little bit of a discrepancy between the SIP and the Survey of Consumer Finances. And with that, I would say, like, the main thing is really that structural obstacles stand in the way for Black and Latino households, as well as those of other multiple races, to save and build up retirement savings as much to the same degree as white households do. What does this mean for policy? I think more emergency savings, greater protections, a number of benefits that can help people address the risks. No employer benefit plan, cafeteria plan can address all of the risks that people will face. But there are more can be done in that way. And the other part is from a public policy perspective. Again, not everything can be addressed through the retirement policy world. And what that means is you need to build up social safety nets. And that is expanding Social Security. And here I'm really veering off what we wrote in the Society of Actuaries report. So do not attribute this to the Society of Actuaries, please. Expanding Social Security, additional paid family medical leave policies, improved unemployment insurance benefits, and so on and so forth, to really counter those other non-work-related or work-related retirement benefits, risk factors that are more common among especially Black and Latino households than they are among white households. Thank you very much.
Great. Well, thanks, Christian. I know I really enjoyed that richly detailed presentation. I think you were able to highlight and emphasize several factors that are not as frequently brought up in these discussions. And I think that that's a real contribution that you and your co-authors have made with this research. So I will encourage members of the audience to submit questions for Dr. Weller to answer. I know we have a couple in the queue already, but please, you know, feel free to type in your questions right now. We'll get to those in just a moment. So Christian, I kind of want to start off where you left off, which is on the topic of emergency savings. I know certainly here in DC, there's been a lot of focus on emergency savings for the past several years from the folks in the broader savings ecosystem. And there has been some real movement in that direction with, for example, Secure 2.0. But what more do you think from a public policy perspective could be done to help increase emergency savings so that folks don't have to take loans or withdrawals from their retirement plans to cover their emergency needs?
It's an interesting question. I think Secure 2.0 and the availability of some small amount of retirements of emergency savings is an important step. When you look at sort of the emergency savings amount or what people take out, we're not talking massive amounts. We're not talking hundreds of thousands of dollars, not even tens of thousands of dollars that people need. And the other part I would say is, if you give people, lower income people, and as we argue multiple times, and as the research, the literature, there is a relatively substantial, robust literature shows, is lower income people, but also Black and Latino households save, can save, will save a similar rate or higher rates than, for instance, white households, in part because they know they live in a riskier world and they need those emergency savings. Now, to answer your policy question, I think beyond just the retirement world, that is not the only vehicle, but there are a number of proposals right now, for instance, for something like baby bonds. They could serve as emergency savings, or at least sort of take the pressure off families to save for their kids' future and give them some room to save for something else for their own. Sort of baby bonds, Montgomery County in Maryland has a proposal. I know Massachusetts studied the issue. Connecticut is doing something. California has a small program in that regard. They're very well targeted. We're talking somewhere between $2,000 and $6,500. $6,500 is that number that got thrown around in Massachusetts. They're substantial amounts that basically a baby would get at birth and could build up. We would have to see, but the suspicion is, given what we know from related research, is that those amounts of money, even though people may not be able to access them, they're there for their kids. They make people feel a lot easier about, like, less stressed about the future. It lengthens the planning horizon, and that reduction of stress, the longer planning horizon, makes it more likely that people will contribute more, keep the money in a 401k and elsewhere. So I think whatever we can do, and like from a policy perspective, I'm sort of find it abhorrent that that's sort of the most promising policy that we have right now on the table, which individualizes risk protections rather than having a discussion over how do we get expanded Social Security benefits or a National Paid Medical and Family Leave Act, for instance.
Yeah, we had a webinar in September with Will Sandbrook, who runs Nest Insight in the UK, and they've done some really interesting research on the impact of financial volatility on the lives of their savers, who are primarily low to moderate income savers. And I think that, again, ties in with your findings relating to risk exposure, that, you know, retirement savings isn't siloed, right? It occurs in a context of people's lives. And to the extent that they're, you know, facing income volatility, they're facing risk exposure, they have to make decisions based on the lives that they're living. And, you know, locking up money potentially for decades for retirement savings isn't always the most realistic option for them.
And I want to say, because this has come up in the context, I am very reluctant. I am opposed to locking up money, retirement money, even more so. People don't do this to party. They do it is because something else goes wrong in their lives. Jeff Winger and I, many years ago, wrote about how people basically take 401k loans because of a health emergency. That tends to be consumption items, such as going on a cruise or something like that, they're not even a blip in the data. So we should make this data, that the retirement savings, available absent any other options that people have, such as nicely widely spread baby bonds and emergency savings and a stronger social safety net.
Well, we've got a number of questions from the audience in now, so I think this is a good opportunity to turn to those. So our first question is, how do whites compare in retirement savings when compared with minorities of the same income? So if you look at people by different races and ethnicities, but you compare them by their income levels, how do the differences look in that regard?
By income level, same, like you still observe. So in the report, we have a number of tables where we break down the various groups by a number of characteristics that we can observe, such as income levels, such as college education or not. That tends to be sort of a big divider. And what you will find is that the gaps aren't like 3-1, but they're maybe 2.5-1. But you still observe, especially between African Americans and white households, still substantial gaps. You got to remember sort of one statistic that my friend Sandy Darity and Derek Hamilton always throw out is that the typical Black households headed by somebody with a college degree has less wealth at the median or the average than the median or average household headed by a white person without a high school degree. And we see like smaller gaps in retirement savings because you have to have a retirement plan at the worker at the workplace, right? But in the end, even in those balances, but even after controlling for income, you still see substantial gaps. Income differences in which you get for your income explain and it decompositions about 20% of the gap. So like without income differences, you're looking still for 80% that need to be explained somehow. The one thing I should really say is, and because that's the next one, people will come and say like, what about education? Educational differences, like it does not shrink the wealth gap. It does not, like if you look college versus college, there are massive gaps between African Americans and Latinos on one side and white households on the other. And that just simply has to do with intergenerational wealth transfers that Black households don't have, white households have. And that just simply has to do with the very ugly history of slavery.
So our next question has to do with defined benefit pensions. And I appreciated your comments during the webinar about how in the public sector, you don't see as great of disparities, right? The gap is still there, but it's not nearly as large in access and participation. And we at NIRS, we released a report last year from Nari Ree that was also looking at differences by race and ethnicity, as well as some other characteristics, but she was focusing specifically on defined benefit plans in the public sector. And one of the things that I appreciated about her report, and I think your report echoes some of the same findings, is that especially when you're in a defined benefit plan in the public sector, the formula is the same for everyone. Right. So how long you work and what you earn while you're working obviously matters, but the pension formula is the same for everyone. So you get much more equitable outcomes from that than you do in, for example, a 401k savings system. But the question from the audience here is, wouldn't more emphasis on defined benefit pensions do more to address this problem than trying to fix 401ks?
Yes and no. So like part of the reasons why we see less inequality with defined benefit plans is you don't get the really high income earner maxing out on their like 401k contributions and catch ups and stuff like that. You don't have sort of the high end shooting away. And the other part is sort of it's more level playing field. But there is another factor. And that's a little hard to disentangle. Defined benefit pension plans at this point are predominantly found in the public sector. The public sector is also heavily unionized, more heavily so than the private sector. And because of the structure of the public sector and because it's unions, what we see is also greater longevity on the job, greater job stability. And in the work that David Madeline and I have done, job stability, tenure with an employer is one of the most important factors to building wealth. And so it's more a question of how do you get access, how do you stabilize jobs? I think, yes, DB pension plans in the data do show greater stability and they would reduce inequality to some degree. But the other part that is sort of under the surface of the story of defined benefit pensions is greater job stability, particularly in unionized jobs or public sector jobs. So the policy conclusion for me is make jobs more stable.
Okay. So kind of related to that, our next question has to do with the minimum wage and to what extent would advocating for a higher minimum wage help to address some of these issues highlighted in your report?
It certainly would help. I don't think anybody has specifically looked at the minimum wage, but we do know from Michael Sheridan's work out of Washington University around individual development accounts is, and what our work shows is that generally people can save regardless of income limits. There's obviously sort of a lower end where people will fall off, and that's true for his work as well. So if you raise the minimum wage, people will just simply have more money. And if they even maintain just the same retirement savings, like the same contribution rate, they will build up more retirement savings. That's one sort of effect. The other one is with a minimum wage, there is a good chance that you're going to get over the poverty line. And beyond the poverty line, this is sort of what Michael Sheridan's work shows, is once you're in the poverty line, people are much more likely to keep the money in their savings account. So for him, in his research, the American Dream demonstration, the poverty line is sort of like a clear dividing line. Everybody saves, but people below the poverty line will dip into the money more quickly than people with more income, with higher incomes. And that's just simply because they have more income. It's easier to handle small emergencies out of their paycheck. And the other part is, and here I speculate, is just simply higher incomes give people a little bit peace of mind, lengthen their planning horizon, make them breathe a little easier, invest the money for a longer period of time. And that sort of builds up retirement savings. But again, that's speculative. I'm not the only one who speculates about this. Gary Becker wrote about this in 1995. So I feel relatively safe. I have a theoretical model I can point towards that proves me right.
So then the next question is, isn't the behavior of contributing more to a 401k and then using the loan to cover an emergency mathematically superior to saving outside of the 401k because of the cost advantage, tax advantages you get from saving in the 401k? As long as you are able to repay the loan.
Yeah, and we make that point with Dania. This is particularly true for African Americans and Latinos who face greater financial market discrimination on average than white households. So they're like acting as a bank to yourself makes a lot of sense. I'm not criticizing this. This is just, I want to point that out when especially, like this is true for Black and white households. When they face the economic risks, they're saving more. That gap between not having risk and having risk is much larger for Black households than it is for white households. But the liquidity needs are also greater. But it makes absolute sense. It sort of shows the need for savings to handle those risks other than the 401k. But absent, if that's like, if you have a 401k and you have a bank that you know is going to rip you off, you're going to go with your 401k.
Great. So then the next question, this is more of a clarifying question. You mentioned the Asian American ethnic group being less likely to save more if they know they have someone in their kinship network that will need financial help. Can you
so,
kind of explain that?
So that this is no. What we find in the work with Dania, we don't talk this in the report. Other households, which in that data set, because we didn't have to survey consumer finances, the 2022 version, does include primarily Asian Americans. They are more likely to participate. Think about it the other way around. Basically, you need some wealth, you need some retirement savings in order to be able to help family and friends. If you have nothing, you can't give nothing. In general, what we find is that Asian Americans have greater family financial obligations. Within the households, they are sort of by far have the largest household sizes. And at least in the SIP, they are highly likely 15-16% provide some financial assistance to family members. One thing I should say is about this, like when you compare sort of financial assistance to a family member outside of the household, like non-white and Latino households look quite different from white households. For white households, that financial assistance is primarily given to adult children. That might be college education help with starting a business or something like that. For Latinos, it's primarily given to parents and grandparents. And for other, like, and similar for Asian Americans and for Black households, Black households are also more likely to give it to two groups, to two households at the same time. It's to kids, to parents and grandparents, and then to other relatives and friends. About more than 30% of the recipients of informal financial support among Black households are siblings and other relatives and friends. So we hammer this point in many, many papers we've written with Dania because it is so widespread. 15 to 20% for Black households, even more than that, provide financial assistance. And it's these kin networks, right? You're talking communities that have very little wealth, very little savings. So one small emergency in one family can ripple through a number of households. And we see this. And again, we're not the only ones. I should say, like Jack Vanderhey points out to the liquidity issue. Taha Chukwane at MIT points also to the liquidity issue. And we're filling that in with the backstory that a lot of this liquidity comes from demand from the kin network.
Okay, great. So did the study look into the impact of student loan debt? To what extent does having student loans play any role here?
That seems familiar. It's not in the report. I do know that the actuaries asked us about it. And honestly, I don't know what the answer is. At this point, I don't remember. I honestly don't. It probably impedes savings a little bit, but by and large, I don't think it's a massive obstacle.
Okay. And then we've got another question here. Should financial literacy programs be required in high schools in an effort to expose younger people to the benefits of retirement savings at earlier ages?
All right, I have 1 minute. I'm going to make it quick. I'm not a big fan of financial literacy arguments. I don't think they can hurt, but I think they will help very little. So here's the evidence. Financial literacy programs have a very low track record of turning, there is financial education, financial literacy programs are all over the place and what they actually teach and what they emphasize. The second part is it translates very little in terms of improved financial knowledge. And then financial knowledge translates very little into financial behavior. There's a very good review that Bridget Madrian co-authored in the Annual Review of Economics that sort of goes through this. It also goes with the story we're telling with the data. Individual behavior matters very, very little in this world. Like once you have access to an employer plan, you will participate in it. So financial literacy, maybe if you have actually two or three options from an employer job offers, you choose the one that has a retirement plan. But I think people do that anyway. People are not on average, not really dumb. They really know that this is worth some money. And so I think it's good. This financial literacy argument also comes up with, like, aren't Black and Latino households investing too little in stocks? Well, if you just look at retirement savings, you could come up with that conclusion. But if you take a holistic approach and you look at their overall risk portfolio, they're probably investing too much compared to white households. We made that argument with another co-author, with Michelle Tolson, around gender, where the same argument comes up, that women are too risk averse. And it turns out, as Julie Nelson and others have shown, they're not. They're completely aware of all the risks around them. They just have more risks, and thereby are more cautious in their retirement savings. So I'm not saying that financial literacy, yeah, I want my kids to learn about that. And the more they learn and it's good quality, it won't hurt, but it won't change. It might be on the margins change a few things, but it won't be a big thing.
Great. Well, with that, we are at the end of our hour. So I want to once again thank Christian for taking time out of his busy schedule to join us today and share the findings of this important report with us. And I want to thank everyone for joining us for the webinar this afternoon. We will be sending out a link to the replay of the webinar, as well as a copy of the slides from today's presentation, both of which will also be posted on the NIRS website in the coming days.
Well, thank you very much for having me, Tyler. This was awesome.
All right, great.
As always, well, thanks. From NIRS.
All right, have a great day, everyone.
Thank you.